Good morning, church. This is the day that the Lord has made and we will rejoice in it. What a day to begin with God and what a day to be at the feet of Jesus. Beautifully, God leads us every day, especially as we spend time at His feet. God continuously speaks to us. He communes with us. That is the heart of God. He wants to have fellowship with us. Friends, this week onwards is a very special phase of life for the nation of India. The first phase of election is going to take place this week. And we ought to pray for our nation. You know, Paul writes to 1 Timothy chapter 2 verse 1 to 5. He urges the church to pray. Prayer should be part of the mainstream of the church. Not just pray for ourselves. Pray for everyone, particularly pray for the leaders of our nation. Let me read those verses for you. 1 Timothy chapter 2 verse 1 to 5. I urge then, first of all, that petitions, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. This is good and pleases God, our Savior, who wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. Verse 5. For there is one God and one mediator between God and mankind, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for people. Paul is very clear and he's commanding the church to pray for all people. Particularly, he's asking us to pray for people in authority. Why? So that we can lead peaceful and quiet life in godliness. When we pray, God changes us. When we pray, God changes people. When we pray for peacefulness and quiet life, we can pray against external disturbance and internal disturbance. Why does Paul want us to pray? Beautifully says, God desires everyone to be saved. That is the center of our prayer. So that every person, every man, every woman, every boy, every girl will come to know the Lord Jesus Christ and will have relationship with Christ Jesus. That is the need of the hour. Even as we go through this week, may we set aside time to pray for the salvation of people. People need to come to know the truth. That is, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Friends, I want to encourage all of us to spend some time to pray for the nation of India. Pray for all the people. Pray for those in authority. Pray for the election that is going to take place. Pray that God will continue to reign over this nation. With that, I want to welcome you all to this worship service where Christ is the center of our worship. Even as we sing songs and bring glory to God, may we tune our hearts and our minds and our souls and our spirit to this living God who desires everyone to be saved. Let's sing together.
Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're and all the ways of man. You were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known. Above all treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified, laid behind a stone, you lived to die, rejected and alone, like a above all. Oh, you were crucified and laid behind a stone. You lived to die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall of me above all, like a rose trampled on the ground, you took the fall and thought of me above all.
You're the God of this city, you're the King of these people, you're the Lord of this nation. You are, you're the light in this darkness, you're the hope to the hopeless, you're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. The greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. You're the God of this city, you're the King of these people, you're the Lord of this nation. You are, you're the light in this darkness, you're the hope to the hopeless, you're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like like our God. There is no one like you, God. For greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you and praise you for giving us opportunities to come to the throne of grace again and again to plead for people, to plead for our nation, to plead for those in authority. Lord, even as we go through this important phase of life in our nation, Lord, I pray that you will please help the church to stand united, intercede for the people of our nation. Intercede for the leaders of the nation, Lord. Oh Master, I pray that you will reign over India so that every person in this nation will come to know you as a personal Savior and will have a relationship with you. Lord, will you please help us to be people of prayer, people who intercede for others with thanksgiving because you are on the throne. Even as we go through the service, I pray that you will speak to us. Speak to our hearts and our minds so that we will align ourselves to you and listen to you and do only what you ask us to do. May you be glorified in and through us. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Church, we continue to journey with the Gospel of Mark. Even as we study this passage this morning, may we ask the Lord, Lord, help me to be a true follower of Christ. Wherever you go, let me follow you. Whatever you say, let me listen and obey and do it. Let me have this communion with you all the time. And let me be with you always so that I can truly grow into the image of Jesus Christ. This morning, Reverend Adrian is going to share God's word with us. May we ask the Lord to speak to us. Reverend Adrian.
I greet you all in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Indeed, it is a great privilege and a delight for me to be with you once again as we open up God's Word. As we study the Gospel of Mark, let us look to the Lord to speak to us in the context of our lives, in the times that we live in, dangerous times, times of apostasy, times of trials, testings, and tribulations. One thing is for certain, that God is with us and He still speaks to us through His living word. Today, as we look to God's word, I pray that His word will be a blessing to you and that your heart will be opened to the plans and purposes of God. Shall we pray for a moment? Heavenly Father, we come to you in the name that is above every other name, the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Father, we want to thank you for all that you have purposed for us through your Son, especially that we could be called the children of God by the richness of your grace. Father, even as we come to listen to your word, open the eyes of our heart. Grant to us attentive ears, and may we put into practice that which we heard to live a life of victory and sanctification. Heavenly Father, we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing in thy sight. In Jesus' most precious name we pray. Amen. Not too long ago, I had the privilege of going to a specific village where we had to do some ministry. And I remember it was late in the afternoon, the sun was blazingly hot, and we sat under the tree, and then this lady runs to us and says, "Please, could you come and pray? Her daughter's being troubled by a particular demon." And at that time, we did not feel encouraged to go and pray. But my wife said, "Please, won't you come? This mum is in distress. And didn't Jesus help the Syrophoenician lady who was in distress?" And forgetting about our tiredness, we went to see and observe what was going on. And there was a girl about 15 to 16 years of age who was tormented and oppressed by a demonic spirit. And as we went there, people were praying and people were watching and some were even laughing at the spectacle. And then we closed the doors around us, we shut the windows around us, and we just began to pray and call upon the powerful name of Jesus. And I still clearly remember this young girl holding her ears and screaming. Then we began to read the Word of God. And as we read from the letter to the Romans, as we read about the grace of God and forgiveness through Christ Jesus, this girl began to scream and shout, and it took six men to hold her down. And then as we began to pray simply in the name of Jesus, this girl was set free from this oppressive spirit. In the nation that we live in, there are many, many examples of such young women who go through such torment by demonic beings. But aren't you glad? Aren't you appreciative of the name that is above every other name? In the name of Jesus Christ that gives us the victory. For at the sound of his name, every knee will bow and tongue will confess. This morning, I title my sermon, "If Demons Could Recognize Jesus, Why Can't We?" If demons could recognize Jesus, why can't we? And our text is taken from Mark chapter 3, verses 7 to 12. Shall we read Mark chapter 3, verses 7 to 12? Now, Jesus withdrew with his disciples to the lake, and a large crowd from Galilee followed. When they heard about all he was doing, many people came to him from Judea, Jerusalem, Idumea, and the regions across the Jordan around Tyre and Sidon. Because of the crowd, he told his disciples to have a small boat ready for him to keep the people from crowding him. For he had healed many, so that those with diseases were pushing forward to touch him. Whenever the impure spirits saw him, they fell down before him and cried out, "You are the Son of God." But he gave them strict orders not to tell others about him. Today I want to share with you something that is truly fascinating. It is a story that is not just a tale that had been conjured up, but it is a powerful message that echoes throughout our time. Imagine for a moment the forces so dark, yet acknowledging a power so bright. This is about the ultimate showdown between darkness and light. And it is right there in the Bible, the scriptures, the Word of God. It is about demons recognizing someone far greater than them, Jesus. And how this contrasts with how some humans respond to him. Demons' recognition of Jesus' authority illustrates his divine power and control over the spiritual realm. This acknowledgement highlights the spiritual conflict and Jesus' supremacy over evil forces. A notable instance of demons acknowledging Jesus' authority is seen in our text today. And it reads, whenever impure spirits saw him, they fell before him and cried out, "You are the Son of God." Yet he commanded them to keep quiet. This passage reveals the supernatural understanding these evil spirits possessed regarding the divinity of Jesus Christ. The demons, despite the evil intent, automatically recognize Jesus as the Son of God and submit to his authority. The significance of Christ's authority over demons was emphasized by the Puritans, and having a strong theological understanding and a deep spiritual fervor, Jonathan Edwards, a renowned Puritan theologian, emphasized in his sermons the might and authority of Christ. He proclaimed, "Christ is the mighty Savior, and none is great as he," portraying Jesus as the almighty victor who conquers the powers of darkness. The acknowledgement of Christ's power by demons and forces of darkness highlights the authority and the divinity of Jesus as described for us in the scriptures. The scriptures recount instances where demons acknowledge and yield to Jesus' authority, contrasting sharply with the response of individuals who choose to despise or reject him. Let us look at a few points, and specifically 5 points that I want to share with you. Point number one, the demonic recognition of Christ's authority. The demonic recognition of Christ's authority. Throughout the Gospels, numerous accounts highlight demons acknowledging Jesus' authority. And we'd find that throughout the gospel. And in Mark chapter 5, we would look at a demon-possessed man cries out, "What do you want to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? In God's name, don't torture me." This recognition reflects the supernatural awareness of Jesus' divinity. And I'm going to repeat that constantly. As the demons could acknowledge the supernatural awareness of Jesus' divine identity, how come is that people still today refuse to acknowledge him as Lord? In our text, we see an explicit acknowledgement by these impure spirits. And these impure spirits, they said, "Son of God," but Jesus gave them strict instructions not to talk to others about him. Now, how do we understand this passage in the context of our life today? Let's look further. Number one, Christ's authority. Christ's authority. The demons' acknowledgement of Christ's authority is demonstrated by their reaction to him. Falling before him is a sign of surrender and recognition of a higher force. This is consistent with the biblical teaching. The biblical teaching that in admitting Jesus as Lord, all knees must bow. Secondly, we find the extraordinary perception of Christ's identity. We see his authority, and now we see Christ's identity. The declaration made by these spirits, "You are the Son of God," indicates a deeper spiritual understanding of his divinity rather than simple recognition. This affirmation comes from the supernatural aspect of Christ's identity, from the heavenly dimension rather than human logic. And then we see Christ's response. It is important to note that Jesus' reaction when the demons acknowledged him, even though they correctly identify him as divine, he gives them strict instructions to keep him a secret from others. Now, this can be interpreted as Jesus asserting control over when and how he will reveal his identity, aligning with the divine plan of salvation and his mission. Now, some other theologians have emphasized the spiritual realm and Christ's authority alongside their theological knowledge. And one young man was Richard Baxter, a Puritan author. And he extensively discussed spiritual warfare and Christ's omnipotence. Christ's omnipotence against evil forces in his work of a book called The Saints' Everlasting Rest. And here Baxter urges believers to seek refuge under Christ's guidance in spiritual battles. The demon's acknowledgement of Christ's authority is depicted in the Gospels, establishes a theological basis of affirming Jesus' divine identity and supremacy over the spiritual domain. Now, Scripture provides evidence of Jesus' authority over demons, and we find in Luke chapter 10, verses 17 to 20, Jesus grants his disciples the power to cast out demons and sends them out to minister in his name. Upon their return, the disciples joyfully report, "Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name." Jesus responds by saying that their mastery over the evil spirits was given by the authority that he had given them, where he says, "I have given you authority to trample upon snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you." The acknowledgement of demons obeying Jesus not only highlights the divine status, but also brings and emphasizes the spiritual domain of his sovereign reign. Understanding that Christ has conquered all spiritual adversaries and reigns supreme over the forces of darkness brings us assurance and confidence as followers. Recognizing that Christ has defeated all spiritual enemies and reigns supreme over the powers of evil beings, believers have peace and confidence. This realization inspires us to submit humbly to his authority and find comfort in his glorious name, the sweetest name that is ever known, the name of Jesus. My second point for today is the submission of forces of darkness. Now we find the forces of darkness represented by demons consistently submit to Christ's authority. In various instances, Christ cast out demons with a simple command, showcasing his power over the spiritual realm. And you can find that throughout the Gospels. Charles Spurgeon said of Christ's power over devils, saying that, I quote, "Christ's dominion is a dominion of grace," unquote. The devils obey him, but they do so in fear because they sense his power and might. This subject has also been discussed by modern theologians like John Piper, who emphasize the consequences for believers in comprehending Christ's authority. Piper once said, and I quote, "The devil is God's devil, and he goes when Christ commands him to do. For those who follow Jesus, this is quite encouraging since it implies that we are under the control of God's power." Let me repeat that. John Piper said, "The devil is God's devil, and he goes when Christ commands him to," unquote. For those who follow Christ, this is very encouraging, since it implies that we are no longer under the control of demonic forces, but we are under the control of God's power, regardless of the demonic forces that attempt to harm us. As the biblical passages and preachers have demonstrated, the submission of the powers of evil to Christ's authority demonstrates Jesus' unrivaled strength and sovereignty in the spiritual sphere. The theological truths highlight the triumphant character of Christ's redemptive work, providing comfort and confidence to all believers. My third point is the human response of despising Christ. The human response of despising Christ. On the contrary, human responses to Jesus vary, and some choose to despise or reject him. This rejection can stem from various factors such as a misunderstanding, pride, or a refusal to acknowledge Jesus Christ as the Son of God. One of the fundamental principles of the Christian faith is the subordination of the forces of darkness to Christ's rule. The biblical narratives, particularly in the New Testament, depict Jesus as having authority over demonic forces. This authority is exemplified in our text today. And we even find in Matthew chapter 8, verse 16, where we read that evening they brought him many who were oppressed by demons, and he cast out the spirits with a word and healed all who were sick. This demonstrates the willingness of demons to obey Christ and the power of his spoken word in overcoming supernatural forces. The submission of demons to Jesus is further emphasized in Mark chapter 1 verse 27, and they were all amazed, so that they questioned amongst themselves, saying, "What is this? A new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits and they obey him," unquote. Now this verse highlights the unique authority of Christ, transcending traditional teachings and impacting the spiritual realm. This principle is also illustrated in Luke chapter 4 verse 41, where it is written, "And demons also came out of many, crying, 'You are the Son of God,' but he rebuked them and would not allow them to speak, because they knew that he was the Christ." The demons confess Jesus' divinity and submit to his authority. This confession highlights their surrender is not merely coerced, but stems from a recognition of his power. Throughout history, people have witnessed the complexities of individuals rejecting Christ. This rejection has been evident since biblical times and grows more so now and continues to manifest itself in various forms today. And one reason for people rejecting Christ is a lack of understanding. Many individuals struggle to fully comprehend the profound teachings and purpose of Christ. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who was known for his insightful reflections on Christianity, stressed the significance of delving deeper into the essence of knowing who Jesus is. He stated, "Cheap grace is the grace we grant ourselves. It is a preaching of forgiveness without the necessity of repentance, baptism without the discipline of the church, communion without confession. Cheap grace lacks discipleship, the cross, and the living presence of Jesus Christ." Another contributing factor to despising and the rejection of Christ is pride. Renowned preacher C.S. Lewis highlighted the arrogance that often hinders individuals from embracing Christ's message. He expressly said, "Fallen man is not merely an imperfect being in need of improvement. He's a rebel who must surrender," unquote. Lewis emphasizes that it is pride and rebellion that stand in the way of individuals in acknowledging their need of Christ as a savior for their salvation. And fourthly, the blindness to spiritual reality. Spiritual blindness can lead individuals to despise Christ. Let's turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 4, which reads, "The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers, so they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of God." What is the nature of spiritual blindness? The Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 4 states, and he brings it very, very clearly. And what is the consequences of spiritual blindness? Spiritual blindness that stems from the influence of the God of this age. What are the gods of this age? Pride, self-centeredness, idolatry, an exemption of God, edging God out. This blindness, theologians suggest, is not a physical ailment, but a profound physical condition that hinders one's perception of divine truth. One theologian described spiritual blindness as soul-afflicting malady that obscures the eternal vision and hides the brilliance of Christ's glory. It is a lamentable state, he said, as eyes incapable of recognizing the light of the gospel remain covered in darkness. And what does the spiritual blindness lead to? Deception. The verse suggests that the minds of unbelievers are deliberately blinded by the God of this age, introducing us to deception, and many are deceived due to the absence and the lack of the understanding of the Word of God. The Word of God is not within them. A prominent scholar once said, "Deception is the handmaiden of spiritual blindness." Why do people despise Christ? The consequence of spiritual blindness, as repeated for us in this verse, is the inclination to despise Christ. The inability to see him as Savior, the inability to adore him as Lord. Hating Christ is an active resistance stemming from spiritual blindness rather than merely a passive attitude. The God of this age obscures perception and draws people's attention away from the source of genuine light and truth. And in the midst of this, Christ is hated beyond understanding. How do we overcome this? To overcome spiritual blindness, let us heed the words of D.L. Moody, who said, "To combat blindness, we must earnestly seek the light of the gospel through prayer, study, and a surrendered heart. It is only through the grace of God that the veil is lifted and we can truly see the glory of Christ." Unquote. Spiritual blindness, as highlighted for us in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4, reveals the gravity of this condition. It ties to deception, the repercussions of rejecting Christ, and the promise of divine intervention for those who sincerely pursue a Savior. And finally, I want to bring a point to you, an invitation to repentance. Despite being rejected by some, there is an emphasis on God's continuous invitation to repentance and acceptance of Christ. 2 Peter chapter 3 verse 9 reads as follows, "The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some may understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not desiring anyone to perish, but for everyone to come to repentance." Demons and forces of darkness acknowledge Christ's authority, highlighting Jesus' supreme might and divinity. The contrast in the attitude of some humans towards him emphasizes the complexities of human free will, spiritual blindness, and the continual need for repentance and faith in Christ. The concept of repentance is a central pillar which brings to us the divine mercy and grace that surpasses human understanding, that we don't deserve it but yet freely receive it. The rejection of this invitation by some individuals, the call to repentance to some individuals, does not diminish the persistent and compassionate nature of God's call to repentance. As 2 Peter 3:9 states, "The Lord is not slow keeping his promises, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance." And there is a clarion call today for a call to repentance. As this verse captures God's patience, emphasizing his desire for humanity to turn from sin and embrace his transformative power through the gospel, through repentance, it echoes sentiments expressed by many preachers over the years who have highlighted the importance of responding to God's invitation through repentance. Charles Spurgeon emphasized God's loving and patient nature. He said in one of his sermons, "God is too good to be unkind and too wise to be mistaken. When we cannot trace his hand, we must trust his heart." Unquote. This idea reflects that God's perceived slowness is a display of his patience and mercy, giving individuals ample time to repent. Jonathan Edwards fervently discussed the importance of repentance in his renowned sermon, "Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God." Edwards warned about the repercussions of rejecting God's offer, illustrating sinners' precarious position over hell. His message mirrors the theological urgency found in 2 Peter 3:9, and that is to repent, emphasizing the weight of choosing to accept or reject the divine call to repentance. And finally, beloved, today, if demons can recognize and acknowledge the supreme power of Christ, why can't we? Several instances in the Bible, we see demons coming face to face with Jesus. And one thing stands out, they recognize him instantly. They call him by name, acknowledging his divinity and deity. What do you want to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God. These words spoken by a demon in the Gospel of Mark highlight something extraordinary. Even the forces of darkness can see who Jesus really is. The question then arises, if supernatural beings who exist beyond our physical world can understand and recognize this, what stops humans from doing the same? This brings us to a rather perplexing contrast. While demons who represent evil acknowledge Jesus' authority, some humans created in the image of God choose to despise him. This isn't about recognizing, it's deeper. It's about denial. Why? It boils down to free will, spiritual blindness, and maybe a bit of pride. We have the freedom to choose, to accept or deny, yet sometimes, like someone choosing to walk in the dark while holding on a perfectly good lamp, we ignore the truth. Free will is a gift, beloved, but it is also a test. It allows us to choose our path. In the context of Jesus, it is choosing whether to follow him or walk away from him. Spiritual blindness, on the other hand, is like having scales over our eyes. We might see, but not perceive. The Pharisees are a perfect example. They saw the miracles Jesus performed, yet they chose not to believe. Their hearts were hardened and their eyes closed. The beautiful part of this entire narrative is the ongoing invitation. Regardless of our past denials or ignorance, the invitation to faith and repentance is always open. Jesus didn't showcase his power to prove a point. He did it to invite us into a relationship with him. Beloved, it's never too late. The door is always open. The acknowledgement of Jesus' authority by forces of darkness paints for us a clear picture of his power and divinity. Yet the true marvel lies in the invitation extended to us, an invitation to recognize, accept, and follow him. As humans, we are blessed. We are blessed to choose light over darkness, sight over blindness, truth over denial. Let us step into that light that is offered to us all, embracing the love, forgiveness, and hope that comes from Jesus.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing comes to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. He didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater.
Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Father, Heavenly Father, Abba Father, loving Father, we thank you for the name that is above every other name, the name of Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you that you have rescued us and saved us so that we can taste and know and see the goodness of your love through Christ in our life. Father, we pray for those who want to accept him, yet in the midst of denial and rejection are confused. We pray, O Lord, that you will remove the spiritual blindness of those who cannot see the glory and the divinity and the deity of Jesus Christ. Father, help us to walk closely to the precious bleeding side of Jesus. And for those today who want to respond to the free gift of life that you offer, I pray, O Lord, that you will melt their hearts, remove their spiritual blindness, so that they can taste and see that you are good. Help us, bless us, and keep us. May your peace remain with us, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much for joining us, and I pray that this word will remain with you as you open your eyes to see the goodness of Jesus Christ. Receive the blessing today. And now may the threefold blessings of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit rest and abide in each and every one of us. Grant to us his peace, to rejoice in knowing the name that is above every other name, the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. God bless you and have a victorious week.